see all of the content made for you by your local governments. Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Please come to order. This is the December 17th, 2018, 7 p.m. meeting of Alamance County Board of Commissioners. Glad to see everybody here tonight. All five commissioners are present. So we'll ask Commissioner Lashley to please lead us in the invocation and the pledge.
Let us pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, we pause at this time to honor you. We thank you for sending your son Jesus to be born, walk on this earth as a man. We thank you for the Christian season that we can honor and worship the Son of the living God. And as we prepare to do the people's business, we ask for your guidance and wisdom. In your name we pray. Amen.
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 Amen. Amen.
You
guys
stand and join in the pledge, please.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, next we have our public speakers. Just want to take a quick moment to go over our public comment policy, which is available to be seen on our website. It was adopted as revised September 2014. The comment period is limited to a maximum of 30 minutes. Then there's the commissioner's response period immediately following the public comment period. Each speaker during the public comment period has 3 minutes to speak. There shall be no more than three speakers on any one topic per meeting. So I'm looking at the list of speakers, and I see there may be four who are here to speak about the same thing. So if the fourth person to speak on an issue is if your name is called, if you just want to say pass or whatever, that would be appreciated. So speakers address the board from the lectern at the front of the room, and please begin your remarks by stating your name and address. If at any time you are not able to make your remarks, if you have them written, you can submit them to our clerk, and then they will be included in the minutes of the meeting. If anybody needs an accommodation, we're happy to do that. If somebody is viewing this on video and you're thinking about coming to make a public comment at a commissioner meeting, if you'll please call the office then and let us know if you have a condition that needs accommodation. We're delighted to do everything we can to make that happen. So with that being said, I mean, there's other stuff in the policy, but I'm going to go read it to you. Take the time to review it yourself, that would be great. Also, one thing I do want to say, though, is that we have on the agenda tonight a public hearing for economic development incentives. And if you're coming tonight to speak specifically about those economic development incentives, you don't need to use public comment time. We will have, and during the public hearing, members of the public who want to address the board regarding those economic incentives will have a separate chance to do that. So you can hold off until then, and then instead of getting 3 minutes, I think you get five, so even better. So with that being said, the first speaker signed up is Michael Kennedy.
Good evening.
Good evening. How you doing?
Mike, good. Good. How are you?
Good.
All right. My name is Michael Kennedy. I'm the Vice President of Sales and Marketing for IC Solutions. We're based out of San Antonio, Texas, 2200 Danbury Street. I'm here to speak about item 8.3 on the agenda, I believe, which is the inmate telephone and video visitation services contract. I believe the results were posted last Friday that ourselves and a competitor named Paytel, a North Carolina-based company, the recommendation was going to be that Paytel be awarded the contract. When we looked further into it, we noticed that during the evaluation scoring, we were tied exactly. We were 93 points, I believe, each out of 100, and the nearest competitor was 76 points. So it was a significant difference between 1, 2, and then obviously 3. What we would like to do is essentially ask the commission to table this award tonight until purchasing gets the opportunity to see the technology, or at least ask for what we call a best and final, or BAFO. And it's very, very, very unusual for anybody in this marketplace, and I've been doing it since 1992, to tie. As a matter of fact, it's pretty unheard of, you know. And so we never heard from purchasing after the tie. We didn't know we tied until Friday when the results were posted. What typically happens, and it gives essentially to make sure, because we know, I guess your mission statement is to make sure it's fair and open to the vendors, and we, you know, all those wonderful magical words that we have. But essentially, what typically happens when it's close is the purchasing department will call in with subject matter experts. Somebody from the facility, the sheriff's department, IT, people from purchasing, obviously, and they allow either a demonstration. Typically, it takes about an hour. Sometimes it can go longer. So they actually see the technology that's been written about in the RFP response. We have a phrase: the paper refuses no ink. And so kind of fleshes out the creative writers in our marketplace. And so so we can prove that we can actually do what we say we can do. So either they bring in a demonstration process, and or they ask for a best and final offer among the two finalists, which would be us. And that typically takes a couple of days, an email saying, hey, try to improve your offer. And guess what? It always improves. And so we would ask that you consider that before awarding this. The fact that it's tied, very unusual. And we believe, obviously, our technology. We're a much bigger company than Paytel. I do know bigger is not always better. You know, but we're also a younger company. Our technology has been placed in very, very large facilities. We have 44,000 inmates in one facility that we installed in 30 days, for example. So we have the technical wherewithal to be able to handle and meet your needs. And I see I have 2 seconds left, so I'm done. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Mr. Kennedy.
Thank you.
All right, next on our list of public speakers is Donna Pope.
Good evening. Thank you for the opportunity to speak. My name is Donna Poe, and I live at 1907 Quakenbush Road in Snow Camp, just 1,000 yards from the proposed Crestone Quarry, approved for construction in January this year without public awareness or input. We, the citizens of Snow Camp, have been told by the county attorney that the permit was in conformance with the conditions set forth in the Heavy Industrial Development Ordinance. This ordinance is flawed and needs to be revised. The permit was approved with only one set of eyes by a planning director who is no longer there. Even the chair of the planning department, Rodney Cheek, shared at the planning department meeting last Thursday his not knowing about the approved permit until he saw the same sign we all did posted at the Snow Camp store 9 months after the rubber stamp approval. Something is definitely wrong. We are hopeful the state permit will be denied as a result from our public hearing this past Wednesday because of the many risks and reasons why this mine should not happen. And we are very thankful to all of you, our elected county commissioners, for your participation in that requested said hearing. And we are especially thankful for the 500 folks that attended same, to the 40 articulate and amazing public comments, and subsequent 70 plus written comments sent to the hearing officer, in which the deadline for the written comments was today. The positive side in all this has been the unity of our communities working together to stop this quarry. And we seek the opportunity to work with the county for an ordinance revision reflecting the ideals and mission with the Alamance County Strategic Plan. It is also our request that a moratorium be placed on the current ordinance to allow the revision process and not let any other heavy industrial class 4 permits slip in during this revision process. We are thankful for the unanimous vote by the Planning Department this past Thursday to recommend to you, the County Commissioners, a vote for a moratorium. We only wish that we could have been a little timelier in our request and you could be voting on same this evening. Thank you again for your time and space to speak.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Thanks. Next is Bill Puff.
Bill Poe, 1907 Quaking Bush Road, Snow Camp, North Carolina. And I was just going to speak on, after going to and being part of the planning meeting the other night, I think I would like to see a broader spec of communication between planning department, planning board. And obviously, there was some miscommunication or non-communication, and then also with the county commissioners. It's bringing forth, especially on heavy, you know, industrial ordinances and those sort of things that would affect public safety and well-being of our environment and our area of Snow Camp. That's all I got. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Poe.
You're welcome.
Thomas Hicks.
Good evening. I'm number 3 and number 4, and that was an error. My name is Thomas Hicks, and I live at 1730 Quaking Bush Road in Snow Camp. Recently, a group of concerned citizens sent a letter to the county attorney requesting additional information regarding the permitting process for the crushed stone quarry located in Snow Camp. Because the letter was on an attorney's letterhead, the assumption was made that the group was planning litigation, and the request for information was refused. The purpose of the letter was to encourage your assistance in establishing full transparency in the process that we used in issuing the permit. Nothing was intended to imply litigation. In the letter, we requested information and missing documents concerning whether or not specific county ordinances and regulations were followed. For example, the heavy industrial development ordinance was determined to be consistent with the Alamance County Land Development Plan. That plan contains a flood damage prevention ordinance which requires that any proposed development in a designated floodplain obtain a flood development permit. The proposed site has two FEMA designated floodplains located on the site. And our question is, did the county require the flood development permit as required by your ordinance? We don't know. The Alamance Land Development Plan also includes a watershed zoning ordinance, which was established to impose higher development standards on land located upstream of and draining into the drinking water supply that is generally imposed on other property. The proposed site contains two creeks, both of which drain into Cane Creek, the Hall River, and ultimately Jordan Lake, which are all major drinking water sources. One of the creeks, Reedy Creek Branch, is designated by the state as a WS5 upstream drinking water source. One of the types of development that is specifically prohibited in the watershed area is industry, and any proposed development in these areas require a plan be submitted to the watershed administrator. Our question was that procedure followed. We can't tell from the file. We are so appreciative of everything that you have done to date, including holding a special meeting to request a public hearing from the state and making arrangements for us to have a big old place out at Sylvan Elementary School. But we are asking the planning department to take a look at the heavy industrial development ordinance and declare a possible moratorium until modifications can be made. We would like to continue to working with you to resolve the discrepancies that we found in the permitting process for Snow Camp property investments.
Thank you, Mr. Hicks.
And I'm done. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Henry Vines.
Henry, how you doing?
Thank you, Commissioners. Good afternoon. I appreciate the opportunity to come and speak at this public hearing. I have talked to each and every one of y'all personally on the issue of the bonds and how we're going to pay for it. I know we voted overwhelmingly for these bonds at like 65-67%, and we voted 45-55% not to impact, put a sales tax on. But 45% of us think that's the way to go. I think that the best way that we can fund this, other than a 6-cent increase or even more, because in essence, the debt that we're incurring is going to be $15 million debt load a year, if you figure on the whole 190,000 at one time. I know we're doing this in a stage form, but we're looking at $15 million. If you break that down in property tax, that's a 10 cent. That's 10 cent in order to accomplish that. Well, that's taking 10 cent off of the 59 cent, so that's 49 cent that this county's gonna have to operate on. We're operating on 59 cent now. So when we get there, I mean, where are we gonna go? I know there's all different avenues that this comes from. We have an availability of a half cent sales tax that we could ask our General Assembly to do. I know that a majority of the voters voted against the sales tax, but tonight I am appealing to the taxpayers. I wanted to take this opportunity for everybody that's listening on TV that's going to see this on video, reach out to these commissioners and tell them that you would rather have a sales tax than a property tax increase. This is the most fairest way we can accomplish this. I don't think that people understood what we were saying. You said you wanted it, but you ain't giving no way to pay for it. So I'm pleading to the public tonight to call each and every one of y'all. I know you don't want to hear that.
Email or
email, and those numbers are available on the website. And if you can't get them, call me. I got them. I appreciate your time and the consideration on this. This is something that we've all got to work together and try to come up with the best solution. Thank you.
Thank you, Henry.
Thank you, Henry.
Thank you, Henry.
All right, that closes our public comment time. Do we have any commissioner responses?
Well, I do. I've got 3 points I want to ask about. Number one, did we ever hear from Colonial Pipeline?
No, we have not. I think they had indicated once they made their comments to the state, they would then share a copy with the county also.
I've heard it 3 times. Mm-hmm. And anybody from the group that's here, have y'all heard from Colonial?
We know that they submitted a written comment to the state, and we had not received a copy of it. I have requested a copy directly from the state.
But you're sure it's gone?
But we do know that they did, yes.
Okay, and we don't have a copy of that, right?
No.
Okay, see if we can get a copy of that.
Of course.
Now, quick question on the jail. You remember the old jail that, Massey or you, but...
Stocker.
Oh. Yeah, Stocker.
Stocker.
Yeah, a little like the Alamo. Mm-hmm. Didn't they put that on a ballot to build a new one, and that was rejected? If you go back far enough?
Yes, sir. I think it is, but we're doing the history.
Right. If I'm not mistaken, that was put on a ballot, rejected, and county still did it. Because they had to do it. Okay. All right, so if we can find out more about that, I appreciate that.
We've got the history over there, and I'll get it to you.
Yeah, and vote totals, if we can find that out, the whole nine yards. Because best of my memory, it was rejected, and the county still built it. Because I remember the old one. God, I'm at that old. Okay, and on the state legislature, as far as the sales tax, if special legislation went through, is that feasible?
Well, we have, the county currently has 2 options for sales tax that both require voter referendum. And so at this point, we don't have any other option. I know there's been a lot of questions asked about the possibility of the commissioners right now at this time just saying, we're going to institute a new sales tax. We can't. We've maxed out what we're allowed to do without the voter referendum. I've understood, I think, some conversations with Mr. Vines that there could be the possibility of a request from this board to our delegates for the possibility of some kind of local act special to Alamance County that would allow the institution of a sales tax. I don't know what the feasibility of that would be.
Is that a legal local bill? Is that what it would be introduced at?
I think that's the conversation some folks have brought up. So.
Now, I asked that we write our representatives and ask, was that feasible? Did we do that?
No, we have not.
Okay, why not? Why not?
Just have not, but I will write them and
okay.
Find out.
All right, because I asked about a week ago, if I'm not mistaken. And I'm sorry I had to ask these questions.
Sure.
Okay, I'm sorry.
Mr. Sutton, I'll tell you that I've called one of our representatives, and I haven't spoken to him about it, but okay. I reached out myself and asked.
Because if I'm not mistaken, Henry, you talked to Riddell, didn't you?
Yes, sir. Okay. I talked to Dennis, and I got a phone call back, and he checked with the council government. There's a half cent available to Alamance County. There's a 2.5 cent cap on all counties of sales tax. There's a half cent still available that has to go through, and it would have to be initiated on a local bill that they would introduce into legislation. First of all, what would have to be was a unified resolution by you five commissioners asking them to impose that half cent sales tax to Alamance County. Once they receive that from you, to a half cent.
Right.
You know, up to a half. Half is the limit. You can't go no higher. That's it. 2.5 cent is the cap. And then it would be up to them to put the bill in. And if all of those are in agreement, it's just a matter of formality going through the process of being introduced. They speak to it, and then it goes to the floor for a vote. We've done something similar to that on a coyote bill that we've introduced and got put through on a local bill, spoke to, and went through that helped let us be able to trap coyotes and everything in Alamance County. It's just Alamance County. It don't affect any other counties. It's just our county.
Well, let's find out what we can do.
Yeah. Is that all, Mr.
That's enough.
The litigation, Clyde, can you clarify that to us,
sir?
With folks that sent the letter to you?
Yes, their attorney wrote me a letter, mailed it about a week and a half after she sent it to you folks, I think. She emailed it to everybody but me. I responded to her letter. And she asked a set of interrogatories, which I'm not going to answer.
We gave her the public records that we had. Somebody came and got them. May have been from the Snow Camp group. And in her letter, she indicated there was no permit granted, but clearly there's a permit in there, stamped approved. Apparently, the records were shuffled, and she's not able to put page 1 with page 2 and page 3. But we have complied with her public records request. But we're not obligated to answer interrogatories. And generally, when I get a letter from an outside attorney, unless it's accompanied with a summons and a complaint, I'm not going to answer interrogatories.
Okay. Just want to know for the record
Yes. What
that was.
Anybody else? All right. If not, then we will move on to approval of the agenda.
I move approval.
Second.
We have a motion and a second for approval of the agenda. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Then we have some items listed on our consent agenda. If everyone has reviewed that, if there's nothing to pull out or any concerns.
Move to approve.
Thank you.
Did you make a motion?
Yeah.
I'll second it.
Thank you. We have a motion and a second to approve the consent agenda. Is there any discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Thank you. All right. Next, we have the public hearing regarding economic incentives for Beckton Dickinson and Company. We will need a vote to open.
I will make a motion hearing. That we go into a public hearing.
For a second.
Thank you. We have a motion and a second to open the public hearing regarding economic development incentives for Beckton Dickinson and Company. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? All right. So now we have started our public hearing, and I will ask if anybody on this side of the room to my left, if there is anybody who wishes to be heard regarding economic development incentives for the company Beckton Dickinson and Company. Is there anybody who wants to be heard? All right, I don't see anybody. How about on this side of the room? Does anybody over here want to be heard on economic incentives for that company? Mr. Vine, come on up.
Nobody else wants to
talk. Doors open.
While you're getting yourself ready, Henry, is there anybody in the overflow room? Could you? Is there anybody in there?
It wants to talk.
If there are people in the overflow room, if y'all could ask if anybody wants to be heard on the incentives, if they come on in here, that would be great. All right, go ahead, Henry.
Okay, thank you. Thank you again for allowing this comment period. I wish we could have heard from the company first so that we kind of could get a little more specific information before we make our comments, but I've talked to a lot of people and I've got a lot of information from some of y'all, and then I think I know where we're at. I just think it's time that we need to say no to incentives here in Alamance County. We do a lot of first things here in Alamance County, and I think that it's time that we quit being held hostage and paying a ransom to get people to come to our good community. This company is probably a real good company. There's nothing wrong with this company. I see nothing that says they're wrong. They're a company that's established here. I would think that they would want to be a good neighbor and just operate here and expand, which is going to be lucrative to them, or they wouldn't be looking at this expansion. This $175 million investment that they're talking about would equal, if they done it all at one time and was paying taxes on the $176 million, at $1 million of property tax that would be generated into our general fund. Now, we all are facing, as I just talked about, we're facing this bond issue, and we're facing 6+ cent property tax increase. Their contribution to the taxes at $1 million would be equivalent on the whole county a 3/4 cent. So that could be 3/4 cent less that you would have to charge all the citizens of Alamance County. There's been discussion that it doesn't cost us anything, but it does cost us as citizens, because when we got needs and the money's not there, then we're the ones that's got to make up the difference of that 3/4 cent. I understand that these are really good paying jobs, and that's good that they're coming with good paying jobs, because a lot of them that we've been getting haven't been good paying jobs. But we also have another company right now that's locating in our area, PRA. I don't think their investment is quite as much, like $17 million is what I've been told. They're looking at 500 employees at $40,000+ a year. They ain't asked for a dime. That's gonna be a pretty good help to this community. Also, we have businesses coming in here every day. We have new housing developments. We have new apartment complexes building on our tax base to help with this. And all of us are paying our taxes. I just think that these other companies and stuff should have to pay their taxes just like I do. I'm helping pay for my way, and I think they ought to be paying for their way. The other thing is, you know, if we look at this in the past, we needed jobs here in Alamance County. We need jobs, you know. Well, we always would like to see jobs coming in, but our unemployment now is as low as it's ever been, at 2.9%. So it's not like we need to bribe anybody to come here so we can get some jobs for people that don't have a job. And I think a lot of these jobs that will be coming may or may not even live here. They may be commuting from other counties into our county. Revenues may or may not be coming in here. They may live in Chatham County or Caswell County, whatever. I just think that I'd like to see this company come in here, and I'd like to see them make this investment. They're already here. I would think they would want to stay here and be good good neighbors and help with our schools, our technical college, in which they're probably going to take advantage of getting training and stuff. I understand there's engineers involved in this. There's other different higher level positions. But I just say I'm speaking out against it, and I would like for y'all to take a stand and say no for one time. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Henry.
Thank you, Henry.
All right. Is there anybody else who wishes to be heard? Come on up.
Good evening, Commissioners. I'm Sam Moser. I didn't want to disappoint you all for not coming up and speaking against incentives. But
at least I'm not as lonely as I usually am.
Didn't want to disappoint anybody. I want to thank each of you for your service. I know you have a lot of hard work, a lot of tough decisions to make, and I thank you for it. You've got a lot of hard work ahead of you. The $189 million bond that we're going to figure out how to pay for. I want to echo what Mr. Henry Vine says. If there's alternative ways other than taxing property owners, let's please try to look at that. We've got Becton Dixon Company asking for incentives. I think it's $2.6 million, something to that effect. I'm not quite sure. I read that in the newspaper. We've read in newspapers for years incentives could be considered corporate bribery, corporate extortion. I've heard that from some of our county commissioners. I've heard that from some of our legislators. I'm not saying this is corporate bribery we're going to hear about this afternoon. I don't know that. I might say that it may appear to be corporate bribery. I'm just not sure. But I did read that I think the company is talking about possibly moving to Sumter, South Carolina, and maybe, was it Broken Bow, Nebraska? Broken Bow, Nebraska? I did some research. If that's the talk about moving to Nebraska, that little town has 3,548 citizens. Nebraska has a population of 1.92 million. South Carolina has a population of 5.24 million. North Carolina has a population of 10.27 million. I would think a company doing business with the population, and we're talking about medical supplies, you would want to be in a state that had 10.27 million. That's just my thinking. I would certainly want D&B to continue business in Alamance County. Obviously, great, great company. We would want them to continue showing support for our employees who have helped make them successful. However, I would like to ask this company to expand without taking $2.6 million in revenue from our county. Revenue that could be used to help pay our county employees, help maintain our infrastructure, help pay our firemen and law enforcement. Revenue that could help support our schools and our young kids in school. To our commissioners, I would like to say, ask not what your commission seat can do for you or for big business. Ask what you can do for your Alamance County citizens, your children, your grandchildren. Ask what you can do for our future generations. If corporate incentives continue, if they continue sharing less and less of tax responsibility, taxpayers will have to make up the difference. I would ask each of you join a cause for a greater human fairness When you vote, vote fairness for all of your citizens, all of our small business people. Just please vote no on these incentives. Thank you for listening.
Thank you so much, Mr. Moser. Is there anybody else who wants to be heard during the public hearing?
Make a motion that we close the public hearing.
Second.
Thank you. We have a motion and a second to close the public hearing. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Okay, I think Mac Williams, are you going to introduce the agreement for economic incentives?
Well, good evening, commissioners and members of the public. I'm Mac Williams. I'm president of the Alamance Chamber. And in that capacity, I also serve as the county's economic development person. And I've had the pleasure of the last couple of months of working with our folks with Becton Dickinson in their Mebane facility for a proposed expansion of that facility. Okay, all right. And so having heard the comments, I'm here to introduce to you a representative of the company to be more descriptive about exactly what it is that they're proposing to do. And he can answer all the questions about the facility, the jobs, the wages, the investment, and that sort of thing. This is an investment over a five-year period. The 175 is over a five-year period, as well as the jobs. I would just say that the incentives, they are there, they're out there, but they're also short term. There's a limited time frame where those incentives take effect, and then 100% of what the company would be paying in property taxes goes to the county. And I would also add that incentives are performance based, meaning that what the company says they're going to do has to be done and taxes paid on it before the incentives are paid back out. And so it's not as if they aren't paying the taxes. They are paying their taxes. But then the incentive is some of that tax money back in form of a grant. So just to make that point clear, that it is performance-based. So without further ado, we've got two gentlemen here representing the company. Chris Houghton is a director for the company, and he kind of oversees for Becton Dickinson. He shuffles the chess pieces around on the chessboard. That's the best way I can describe it.
Good enough.
Okay, good enough. And then also, Paul Kuntz is a local attorney who has been engaged to help them with the incentive agreement, which is also on your agenda to look at. That's actually what you're actually voting on, is the terms and conditions that are stated in the agreement. So Paul's here to help with any discussion or question that might be going on about that. So without further ado, Chris Houghton, he can describe the project.
Thank you, Mac. Good evening, commissioners. Thank you very much for giving us the opportunity tonight to speak to you, give you a little bit more information about BD or Becton Dickinson, about the project in particular, and answer any questions you may have. So again, my name is Chris Houghton. I am responsible for moving the pieces around. My job is operations strategy for BD or Becton Dickinson for about a third of the company overall. And my job is really to identify where we should manufacture what around the world. And I'll talk about that a little bit more. So without further ado, who is BD? BD is a large multinational corporation. And at our heart, we are a manufacturing company. So overall, we have about 65,000 employees globally, about 40,000 of them are focused on manufacturing activities. So it is what we do. We're a technology company, but we're mainly a manufacturing company. We have over 70 manufacturing sites worldwide registered with the FDA, that is manufacturing components for sale in the United States. Getting a little bit more specific, focusing here in North Carolina, because BD has a long history of operating in North Carolina in particular. We do operate currently here in Mebane in Alamance County. Actually, I spent 15 years of my life growing up working in that plant, running that plant between Burlington and Mebane. So have a lot at stake here as well. The Mebane site is a manufacturing plant for a cancer diagnostic business, which the business itself is headquartered in our Durham office, which is the second star up on the map. So operations are in Mebane. The business itself is headquartered in Durham. And then the largest of the sites is in RTP, just down the road from the Durham site. It is actually the global R&D headquarters for BD as a whole, the entire company. Really doing the innovative development of new technologies that we don't know exactly what they'll be used for yet, not a product, concepts and technologies that we figure out how they're going to work to make patients' lives better later on. And then the fourth site, which thank you very much, is in Four Oaks. It is a distribution center used by BD globally. Distribution all up and down the East Coast of the United States. So significant representation, over 600 employees currently for BD across these four locations. If we look at BD as a whole, again, it's a big, kind of complicated company, even for those of us who are kind of embedded in it fairly deeply. I'm going to focus on a third of the company, which is what our focus is here tonight. Because BD is split into three major segments: life sciences, medical, and interventional. The medical side, just to hit on it, really, it's sharp, pointy things. Every time you get a shot, every time somebody sticks a needle in your arm, we probably made it in our medical segment. So it's really syringes to do injections. The interventional side is for more long-term care. It can be for chemotherapy. It can be for colostomy bags, anything like that, which is really going to be a port, a catheter that's installed for long-term use. Our interventional side will handle that. My part of the business is life sciences, which includes diagnostic systems, biosciences, and pre-analytical systems. So that's where we're going to focus. Within diagnostic systems, the Mebane and Durham sites that I mentioned earlier are within diagnostic systems. It's really where we are doing diagnostics for anything that a patient may have. And this is anything from a hospital-acquired infection to strep and flu to cancer diagnostics to sepsis if you're deeply sick and they don't know why, a test for bloodborne infections. So really, any time a patient presents with almost anything, we have a test for it. And our diagnostic systems business is focused on that. The next piece of it is biosciences, which is a little bit more on the research end, doing a lot of things with the NIH, doing a lot of things with universities, doing some developmental diagnostics and just pure research with some of those institutions. And then finally, pre-analytical systems, which is the part that we're targeting for potential expansion in Mebane. I'll go into that a little bit more. So pre-analytical systems overall, the easiest way to think about it is when you go to donate blood, or if you go to the doctor, you're sick and they need to take a blood sample, or a sample from any other part of your body, but mostly it's blood samples, both the port that they put into your vein and the collection tube that they attach to it, are made by pre-analytical systems. It's pre-analytical, so it's prior to us doing the diagnostics, they're doing the sample collection itself. So that includes vacutainer tubes, which we're all aware of. They plug in and they pull the blood out of your body and keep it in a preservative for later diagnostics. So we serve customers around the world out of PAS. There are hospitals, laboratories, blood banks, public health agencies. Everybody uses this technology on a daily basis, millions and millions of times. The biggest thing, can you tap back again, please? Okay. The biggest thing that we are focusing on now within pre-analytical systems is trying to improve the comfort of the stick when we put the needle in your vein, and also healthcare worker safety, because one of the major issues is accidental needle sticks after the sample's been taken. The healthcare worker can inadvertently stick themselves, and then they're exposed to bloodborne pathogens from that patient. The newest technology that we're planning to put in Mebane, if all goes according to plan, is it's called a push-button device, where you put the needle into your arm, you push a button, and the needle automatically retracts into the housing, and it is no longer available for the healthcare worker to accidentally stick themselves. So it's both more comfortable, and it reduces or eliminates the risk of an accidental stick. So it's really focused on improving patient safety, patient comfort, and healthcare worker safety is really where we're going. So looking at the architecture, these gentlemen did talk accurately about where we have the sites that are under consideration. I do want to clarify, we're not considering relocating existing operations from Mebane to these sites, just to be clear. So the Mebane operation is intact and is secure. What we're looking at is potentially where to put the next pre-analytical system lines as we need to grow within this business. Where they operate today is in Sumter, South Carolina, and Broken Bow, Nebraska, as the gentleman described, plus Plymouth in the UK. What we are looking for now is where we're going to put our additional lines as we continue to grow this around the world. And that's where Mebane starts to come in. Sumter and Broken Bow are already large plants. They already manufacture this product. And our decision is between growing them further or having Mebane become another site where we're manufacturing this technology. And that's where we would like to go. But Sumter does obviously offer a significant number of economic advantages due to scale. And those are some of the things that we are trying to overcome here by starting up a new site. And that's the reason for the application and engaging with you. A little more detail and information about Mebane itself, our manufacturing site that we have. Again, our focus is on cancer diagnostics, specifically cervical cancer that women present with. So we manufacture both sample collection as well as all of the diagnostic reagents and disposables that are required to do high quality, high efficiency testing with a very low level of indeterminate results, which can result in a patient coming back for a repeat. So our technology is very accurate. It is also, it minimizes the risk of a patient needing to come back. So we manufacture the collection, stains, reagents, and kits with all of that put together. The site itself today has about 83 full-time employees. The building is 100,000 square feet in size as it is. We've built out about 60,000 of that, and that's what's in use today. That leaves us with about 40,000 square feet that's available, and that's what we would target to bring these new pre-analytical systems lines into before we would need to expand, which we would need to do within the next couple of years, because we'd need to go significantly beyond this 100,000 square feet. So getting to that piece in a little more detail. So on the left is a blow up of the site itself, showing what we have built out in white, the available space in green. On the east side of the building, we can expand by an additional 50,000 square feet if we choose to. It's a prepared pad that's easy for us to expand on. And in addition, when we purchased this site back in 2009, we purchased the 8 acres next door with the expectation that we might want to expand one day. So the 8 acres next door are available, and that's more likely the direction that we would be expanding within this 5-year window, should we choose to go this direction. So the project scope itself would be for up to 8 new production lines. These are highly automated, highly advanced production lines, not manually moving things around, not manual packaging. It is automated assembly in a very technically complicated way. I've seen the lines run previously, and they kind of look like magic to me. It is, so that's why we have, like the gentleman we're referring to, a very high investment, but not as high a headcount hire as you would expect in some operations, because it is highly automated with a lot of focus on electromechanical expertise to keep manufacturing lines running as opposed to manual assembly. So very high skill sets required to run this operation. Out of the 116 full-time employees we're targeting to hire, about half of them are salaried professional, and about half of them are direct labor. And the average salary, as mentioned, is about $65,000 per year. On the low end, it can be in the toward 40, 50, and then obviously the salaried professional, highly skilled engineering can go higher than that. I mentioned the potential to expand the facility. It could go as large as 300,000 square feet of new manufacturing space, taking us up to about 400,000 square feet in total when we are done, with the $176 million in total investment previously referred to. So I'll just open it up to questions from the commissioners in
particular. Let me ask you this.
Yes, sir.
Is Pell's company traded on the stock market?
Yes, sir.
Okay, it's public.
Yes, sir.
Okay. It helps me.
How much capital, I mean, you're not putting a lot of square footage on the ground.
Correct.
As the machinery is where the
That's correct.
Money is.
That is correct.
And I guess my biggest question is how does that work in our formula as far as depreciation on machinery?
So the company's planning to do investment of up to $70,600,000 in real property, personal property of up to $105,400,000 total investment potential. When we run our numbers on our formulas on those numbers, we build in a 10% depreciation on the personal property. Yes. So we're figuring our cash flow based on depreciation of the company's
So you calculated that into these numbers?
Yes.
Do you have any competitors locally in the region here or Research Triangle Park or what? They do the same thing you do?
For these specific products, not that I am aware of.
Anything close?
I'm trying to think of the closest competitor. I believe that we have a competitor in the syringe area in Western North Carolina.
As far as diagnostics.
Excuse me?
Sarsted?
It might be. Yes, sir. In the diagnostics area, BMRU is in Durham, and they are a competitor in the diagnostic space.
What about LabCorp?
LabCorp is actually a customer of ours. They don't compete with us as much as they purchase our equipment, our diagnostic equipment, and the tests themselves, and then they run them. So they're one of our large customers.
And everything you have out there in Mebane, you've purchased. You're not leasing any of the property or building. Is that correct?
That is correct. We were previously in a lease site in Burlington and moved into the Mebane site, which is fully owned.
Okay. Last question. Did you receive incentives for the first development part?
Not that I am aware of.
Did we?
No.
Did they ask?
No, I don't believe so. There was discussion about it, but that didn't come to the board.
You have 40,000 square feet in the existing facility. How much do you plan, how many square feet do you plan for the 8-acre site?
It would be about 300,000 square feet added on, and it would span across from the existing building, basically add on to it
in stages.
And occupy some of that 300,000
in stages.
It might be one build at one time to build the shell, or it could be done in stages. That detail is not done yet.
And Mebane has already granted your request, is that correct?
They approved them recently, yes, sir.
Y'all got any quiet tonight?
We're waiting for you, and you got a few.
I don't have any questions myself. I mean, if y'all know what to do, if we want to make a motion to approve the agreement.
I'll make the motion we approve the agreement.
Second that.
116 jobs is hard to come by.
At those wages.
High paying jobs.
Good paying jobs, that's right.
Okay,
before we vote, may I make a comment?
Of course.
Is that in
yeah, go for it.
Thank you. I'm glad you're here. I wish you'd caught my wife's cancer. So I have nothing but compliments to people who are trying to help our healthcare industry. Philosophically, I'm diametrically opposed to incentives. I voted no for years, and I'm going to continue to vote no. The only points I've ever tried to make on this is against the law to waive your taxes. Tax abatements, it's against the law. But we can give you cash. Now, there's something wrong with that formula. And I'll always stand on that ground. Steve's been in banking, I've been in banking, and a banker would go to jail for going to a client saying, give me your payroll, I'll give you 10% or 5% or 3%, or I'll give you $10,000, you can go to the beach with it, whatever. They'd go to jail. But it's okay for government to do it. There's something wrong with that. This board years ago voted a resolution and sent it to Raleigh to ask the state legislature to take us out of the bidding wars. High Point and Greensboro got into saying, we don't want to bid against each other. You know, take us out of it, please. Let's come to an agreement that will neutralize and be neutral on this. And so we sent it to the state. Didn't do any good, I mean, but at least it was lip service from this board, and then the board kept voting for us. But at least we did
and
that.
And the state's busy doing this.
Yeah, so I'm not mad at anybody that votes for them. It's just that I don't understand the logic. Never have. I voted for them at one time, and then when I saw that, who was it, Sheets or somebody was trying to get, the contractor was trying to get incentives for Sheets in Guilford County, I said, okay, that's it. I've had it. No more. And so I vote no, but no offense, I'm not mad at anybody, and I hope someday the government will take us out of it. If the state wants to give them, fine. But it's hard to debate, in my mind, the fact that we can't waive your taxes, but we can give you cash. There's something wrong with it, and I'll stand on that. So I'm ready to vote.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Is there any further discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed?
No.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for your time this evening.
Thank you.
The next item on our agenda is a presentation by the Alamance Burlington School System about the budget for fiscal year 18-19, so the one that we are currently enjoying.
Madam Chair, Commissioners, we appreciate the opportunity to be here this evening and share an update on our 2018-19 school budget. We understand we have a responsibility to be good stewards of the financial resources that are made available to us locally at the state and federal level, and a big part of that is being transparent, and that's part of the reason that we're here this evening, to share where we are with revenues across all of those revenue sources, including grant funds, and then taking a look at where those dollars are going to go, which I'm sure you're aware the overwhelming majority will go into salary and benefits for folks that work in the school system. The relationship between a school board and superintendent are really critical in terms of advancing school systems, improving outcomes, making sure we're doing a good job in allocating our resources. Right behind that, though, is the relationship between the superintendent and the chief financial officer. And the chief financial officer, I'm real pleased to introduce this evening for Alamance Burlington School System, is Mr. Jeremy Teeter. He was one of the first hires that I had the opportunity to make in coming to Alamance Burlington, and I have been very impressed with his diligence and already identifying areas in which we think we could get some improvement from both processes and perhaps in terms of allocation of those resources. We also very much are looking forward to working with you all closely on lots of different issues. We've heard a little bit about one of those tonight, and that is the bond and as far as the school system goes and the capital improvements that those will bring about and how it is that we're going to finance and pay for that building. So we're looking forward to working closely with you all and making that happen as well. So with that, I'm going to turn this over to Mr. Teeter, and he is our numbers guy, and he's got some details for you, and if there's anything else that I can respond to at the closure of his remarks, I'd be happy to try and do that. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening, Chair Gailey and Commissioners. It's good to be in front of you this evening. It's a different context than it has been in the past, but I appreciate the opportunity to present to you. First, we just wanted to start by putting our revenues in front of you. As you can see from that chart, we're very much a state-dependent entity, as you would expect. But we certainly do not dismiss the level of funding that we have received from you this year. You were very generous in honoring our continuation request for the 18-19 school year, and that has played a critical role in our ability to continue to do business as normal and not have to make tough choices this year. So again, we appreciate you in that respect. We do, as most school systems in North Carolina, receive a number of federal grants that we manage. And we'll get into more details on all these funding sources here shortly. We do also receive capital funding, in which you are a part of, and again, we appreciate the $1 million from local dollars that you sent our way this year in order to take care of our critical projects. We do have two enterprise funds that are a part of our operations. We manage a child nutrition program, which is one of the few in North Carolina that's self-sufficient, so we're not having to provide state or local dollars to make it operate. It turns a profit on its own. And we do operate a profitable daycare program that ultimately generates additional dollars that we're able to push back into those schools. We're also fortunate for the community that we live in, Alamance County. We have a number of generous foundations and individuals who go into their pockets to provide us resources to make things happen and to help us satisfy special needs. And so over $7 million this year anticipated in grant sources and donations from the community. So the first item that I'll touch on are the state funds. And so as Dr. Benson alluded to, we do use the state dollars to primarily pay benefits, salaries and benefits. And so we're looking at teachers, looking at school administration, support staff, teaching assistants, and we'll get into more detail on that here shortly on how we're breaking out that staffing with those dollars. But as you can see, the lion's share of that money is indeed going to support our staffing. The next category of interest are the local dollars. And this is an area in which, A, as I said, we appreciate you providing the dollars you have provided. And two, the county has always worked very well with the school system in giving us flexibility with managing those dollars. The state of North Carolina and our federal programs provide very complex rules. We're only one of seven states in the country that are funded the way we are with state dollars. And so sometimes it makes it difficult to piece that puzzle together. And the local dollars play a very large role in our ability to make things happen quickly and easily when we're building a budget. We still do have a healthy share of salary and benefits that come from these dollars. But we also use the money that you give us to take care of facilities, keep the lights on, as well as providing the instructional supplies that get directly into the hands of our teachers and students every day. And again, we will get more into details on that here shortly. Federal funds, again, you see the trend here. Salary and benefits is another large share there. Some of the major federal programs there are intended to provide additional support to our schools that are in communities with the majority of the students who are on free and reduced lunch. So our lowest income students benefit from some of these federal programs. These programs also benefit our children who have severe learning deficiencies or have severe handicaps. And these programs provide us the additional resources we need to meet their needs and give them the equal education that other students might otherwise receive. And so you'll notice, it may seem kind of strange, you'll see there we have a line item on there that says capital outlay. And so those, in every instance there where you'll see a capital outlay expense, that means that those programs have purchased a piece of equipment that's greater than $500 in value. And so we may have some students who require specialized equipment. And so those are our efforts to meet their needs.
Jeremy, before you move on, may I ask a question? You mentioned free and reduced lunches. Can you expound on that just a moment? Is that item up there on the board?
So we do not have specific data in the presentation about the percentage, but we do know 68% of students in Alamance Burlington schools right now qualify for free or reduced lunch. And so the federal government looks at those numbers to drive how much additional support we might receive to benefit those students. So they recognize that we may have additional challenges meeting the needs of those students. And so 68% is significant. And we find elementary level, it tends to be higher. Middle, it drops off a little bit. And then high school, it drops off further. And we find that, the students are maybe embarrassed to turn in the application for free or reduced lunch. And we see a fall off in that. Some of our schools, the degree of poverty is so high that every student in the building automatically qualifies without having to actually apply for the benefit.
Is there a dollar figure that comes in that's beyond the cost of the actual lunch?
There is not. So when our child nutrition program completes a reimbursement process, and so we share with them the number of meals that were served at the set breakfast or lunch rate, and then they reimburse us a month in arrears for those dollars.
So it's actually, you bill them, they pay it.
Yes, sir.
But there's nothing left over.
Correct.
Okay.
The grant funds is another area of interest, and so we do pay for some personnel out of those grant dollars. Our pre-K program is managed through the grant fund. We receive money specifically from the state of North Carolina that passes through the Partnership for Children. Then it drops down to us, and we send them a bill each month. We tell them how many kids we have in the program, and they pay us that rate. This is an interesting note for the public in that some of your lottery dollars go to support those pre-K programs, and so that does not come up in conversation a lot. We only think about construction sometimes, but pre-K programs in North Carolina are supported by lottery dollars. And we do see a lot of supplies there in this particular category. We were fortunate to get support for new playgrounds at some of our schools that we might otherwise not be able to put in place. And so now we get into a little more topic of interest here. We're starting to break down these individual funds. And so if you're looking at all, so this is looking at our state, local, federal, and our grant funds, you can see that teachers constitute the largest share of the dollars that we're spending on employees. And then school administrators are right behind that. And then the instructional support, like teaching assistants. Supplementary pay is a large category there, and those are the local dollars that you all share with us in order to pay competitive wages for our teachers. One line also that is often of interest in the public, and it has been in both school systems that I've worked in now, is the central office administration. And so our central office compensation is just a little over 1% of our total budget. I spend a lot of time comparing the system I'm in now to the smaller system that I came from. And here in Alamance, we have a grand total of 32 folks who you would consider a coordinator, a director, an assistant director, or an assistant super of some variety. And so we've got 36 schools that those folks are serving. And in Caswell, where we have 6 schools, we have 10 of those folks. And so if you kind of draw that to scale, you know, and if you carry that same train of thought here, we really don't have a lot when you scale us up to smaller counties. And so we try to be mindful of that. We're keenly aware of public perception, and we work hard to minimize what we have going on at central office. And I will say also related to that, we're in a unique position where you have the superintendency and the CFO positions have changed hands at the same time. And so we're asking a lot of tough questions at central office about, you know, what are you doing, what's your function, how are you contributing to outcomes for children. So we're looking at everything very carefully. And so I know Dr. Benson has already been busy reorganizing things at central office to take what we have and make it do even more for kids. The next category, so this just breaks it down further to say, okay, let's take these salaries and benefits. How much local money are we putting towards those salaries and benefits, and what kind of employees are we funding? And so again, kind of going back to that central office dollar, it's $765,000 from local. We get about, and you'll see this in just a moment, about $1.1 million from the state specifically for central office, and they give us, so as I talked about sort of their rules and allotments, we get $1.1 million from them where they say, hey, you have to spend this on folks who work at central office. So we exhaust those dollars, and then we're spending a fairly small amount above and beyond what we get from the state. Another challenge we've had with the state and central office administration is that over the last 2 years, the state has reduced funding for those positions by 11.6%. So that's shifted a little more burden to the local side of things to keep folks in place at central office. Another area that we're particularly proud of with our local dollars is the amount of money we're spending on workers' comp. When I came on board in July, I was a little taken aback, just being fully transparent on what we were spending on workers' comp. We've done a couple of things. One, we've already seen a $104,000 reduction in what we're spending in that area. Part of that was challenging the way our workers' comp provider was assessing our risk or assessing the calculation of the premium, and so they were including some contracted services in there that should not have been in there. That was the responsibility of the contractors to take care of workers' comp and not ours. So we saw that savings right off the bat. And we're also now working with folks who have or departments that have a lot of occurrences of workers' comp claims to drive those down. And so you know, that number's 100,000 less this year, and I hope when I'm here next year, it'll be even lower. That's definitely an area of focus for us, to get more money out of things like that and into supporting children. So the next category is services. And so anytime, I know for our board in particular, I get lots of questions from the school board about contracted services and making sure that we're not spending money on folks to do things that we should be able to do for ourselves. And as you're aware from the most recent budget process, our greatest contracted service is our custodial contract. So that contract's a little over $3.2 million. Other items in that total include about $550,000 for SROs that we contract with from the municipalities, as well as EMS services that have a presence at our athletic events. Some of those contracted services are connected to our specialized programs, and so we have dual immersion programs where students get to learn another language. There are some we work with a contractor to locate those teachers for us, bring them in from other countries, and to handle their training. Professional development is a big piece of our services. So our teachers are required, and our principals are required to get a certain amount of professional development, and they earn credits every year. And that's a perk of working with us, is that we help take care of those expenses that come along with that. Printing is pretty substantial. So, you know, you've been in school, teachers use a lot of paper. And so we see a lot of printing costs. Utilities is another large service on our staff. It takes a lot to power those buildings. But we're grateful that, you know, with your support in performance contracting, we'll see that utility number come down quite a bit over the next few years. And we're also, I know Dr. Thorpe is not here this evening, but we were able to successfully close on that performance contracting on the 14th, and work will start on making those improvements in January. So we're very excited to see all that come to fruition. So this next slide just further breaks down the services that we're using the local dollars for. And as you can see, the bulk of that is coming from local for contracted services, and that's with the custodial contract and SROs being the two big chunks there. We do have some maintenance needs that we have to contract out, so occasionally we do have to call in contractors to do some work on our facilities for us. And so those are really the main points that I wanted to hit there with you all for local services. Supplies, and so this is another area of interest. The top line with supplies and digital resources, that just includes things we're getting in the hands of students, books, paper, software. And so we're now at a point where every teacher has a device in their hands, and the last I checked, within 500 or so students of every student having a device in their hands of some nature. And so our teachers are using more and more software to reach our students. So at each school, we award $70 per student for instructional supplies and $25 per student for software in order for them to purchase what they need to reach those kids. Operational supplies would include things like heating oil, fuel for the buses, tires, things of that variety, equipment that they're using in our maintenance facilities. Our event expenses are not too terribly high, and that's mainly expenses that are incurred with field trips or any time that we need to rent a facility that's not one of our own. Non-capital equipment would be any kind of equipment we have purchased. Generally, it's going to be a computer of some variety that lands in that category as far as our expenses are concerned. And so this just further breaks down how much of that is coming from local. And so I already had gone into detail on what a lot of these things are, but that just shows you what we're able to do with your local dollars.
May I ask you a question?
Yes, ma'am.
At budget time, we get a lot of concern comments from the public about books and
sure.
textbooks, things like that.
Mm-hmm.
So the supplies and digital resources, the textbook money would be included in that.
So some schools do use those dollars to buy actual textbooks, and so we have an allotment from the state that is specifically for tech. We can choose to do textbooks or software, and so it just depends on the need at that school. So we're we're deferred to them to determine what their needs are going to be. But I have seen a blend of textbooks and software purchases coming through this year.
So the textbook buying decision, what is purchased for a particular school, is that the principal's decision?
So we have a curriculum department that works with them to determine approved textbooks, and then they make decisions on, you know, how many can we get, how many could we afford with X, Y, or Z dollars. And I think one challenge that we find with textbooks is, as a district, if we adopted just for one subject area the same book across a certain grade level, it would be about $1 million. So textbooks have gotten really cost inefficient, and some of that I blame on the industry. You know, if you've had a kid going through college, you see how expensive the textbooks are, and so that's become a real challenge for all school systems. And I think that's got a lot to do with why we've seen so much movement to software. We've gone a lot further with that. And one thing we really, I have heard, just kind of being in the trenches with folks purchasing these things, is that they'll buy a piece of software and they can put a student on that machine. And this is especially the case at Hallfields, that's had a lot of success. He'll get those kids on that software, and it'll figure out exactly where they are, and it can determine this student is this degree below grade level, so we need to start them at X, Y, or Z lesson to get them on track. And that's a really powerful tool that some of our successful schools have been using with software, but we still do see some textbook purchases that come through.
So if a parent's concerned about the textbooks in the school, who's the best person for them to reach out to with those concerns? Is it the teacher or the principal, or?
I would say they start, and Dr. Benson, correct me if I'm wrong, maybe Dr. Boss's area in Kariki. So Dr. Boss, the assistant superintendent for student learning, would be a good place to start. So she'll be familiar with what all 36 schools have in place for their plans.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
Yes, ma'am. So this was another topic of concern for every school district, just the number of students that we have transitioning into charter schools. And so, as you know, the school system kind of functions as the middleman. And so we get the dollars from the county, and then as our students opt to enroll in a charter school instead, we have to ensure that the local money follows them to that school. So general statute requires us to share the county appropriation and any fines and forfeitures that we receive from the court system on a per pupil basis. As you can see, this year we have a little over 1,500 students. We do have three charter schools in the county, but not all 1,500 of them go to those three. We do have some who choose to go to a charter school in Guilford, Chatham, Orange, just sort of all over the place. And that represents about 6% of the dollars that we're receiving that ultimately funnel over to the charter schools. And we receive a bill from them each month, and we verify that those students do indeed live in the boundaries of Alamance County.
And when you quote an attendance or capacity or whatever, that includes the charter schools, right?
So if we're identifying for you how many kids we have in the system, we do not include them.
Oh, you don't?
We only include who we actually have enrolled. Mm-hmm. Yes, sir. And so in this charter school number is one that we have seen grow at about a rate of 1% per year. That are choosing to go to those schools. But anytime that we pull numbers to identify what is our total enrollment, we share the number that are physically enrolled. And when the Department of Public Instruction allots money to us, they look to see how many kids did they have in charter school last year. We're going to reduce them by that much on state. And then every year, and it's usually by the end of November, they will true that up and look to see how many was their guesstimate correct, and so they'll determine if they need to make an additional reduction in our state dollars or not. And I think this year, when that adjustment occurred, you know, we had to forfeit a teaching position from our state dollars after they adjusted for our growth in charter schools. So anytime you look at numbers from us or from them, they're capturing how many kids we have in charter schools.
But that's on state money, right?
Right.
Okay, what about local money?
And local money, anything, if we came to you with a presentation about our per pupil funding, we're reflecting the number of kids we have in our seats. Yes, sir.
But when you give them the local money, the charters is coming out of really the barrel for the other kids in a way.
In a way, yeah.
I did not know that.
Yep. So we're the middleman, and I know that the charter school lobby, for lack of a better word, has been asking to cut the middleman out and have the ability to come directly to funding bodies. And I think they're also looking for a share of capital outlay, because right now they're on their own for facilities, and they've got the authority to borrow money to build. And so there's some conversation going on around cutting us out of the middle. And I don't know if it'll get any traction in the long session, but that's certainly something on their radar to come to you directly.
Now, is any consideration given on private and online as far as money's given?
So as far as if we have, let's say, for example, if a new private school opened in Alamance County and 400 of our kids chose to go to that private school instead of enrolling in Alamance Burlington, the state would capture that in our decreased enrollment, and so we would see a drop in our state dollars because of that. And we are seeing some of our charter schools are considered virtual charters. So we do have some students who are choosing to enroll in online schools. I think their name's Virtual Academy. The one thing I do like about them is general statute allows us to pass a lesser rate onto them. So they get earmarked in general statute, and we have to pay them less money than we would a normal charter school. So if they're going to go, send them to a virtual. Yeah. So we get to keep more money. The next topic is capital revenue. So these revenue sources are in addition to the $1 million that we get from the county. So typically you don't see the insurance proceeds category. That $890,000 is connected to our claims for the roofing at Broadview Middle and Cummings High Schools. And so I believe those roofing projects are actually very close to completion. So weather has not been our friend this year for a lot of reasons. And the figure for lottery, that reflects some carryover from the prior year, as well as additional dollars that we're receiving this year. The bond interest category is always a funny topic, and I made a joke with Ms. Evans about that the other day, that the bond that bond passed when I was a junior at Cummings. And so I kind of chuckled. I said, well, what is this bond interest deal? And so she explained that when we sold those bonds, we held that money in an interest-bearing account. And so this $256,627 is all we have left from the earnings on that. And we have made some fairly substantial purchases out of those dollars this year. So if those are not exhausted by the end of this year, definitely by next year, that will totally be behind us, which is very timely with the new bonds coming on board.
I have a question.
Yes, ma'am.
Do y'all get money from the sales tax, a percentage of the sales tax?
So there are two angles on that. So I know that at the county level, a percentage of the local sales tax goes into a school capital reserve fund that sits on the county's books. And then that money is earmarked for school construction or capital outlay. And then that works somehow into your budget process on how you feed those dollars into the capital funding stream. And then as far as sales tax in general, we're responsible for paying the state portion of sales tax on anything we purchase. It's been a number of years ago that we lost our exemption from sales tax altogether as school boards, but the local share, so that 2 cents that's local, we ultimately have refunded to us. And I believe on the local funding slide, there's $130,000 we're estimating we'll get back this year in local sales tax that we paid. And we're hopeful that the state will consider this year giving us the state exemption back, and that'll give us some of our purchasing power back as a district. So those are kind of the two angles that I think about with sales tax in schools.
That's a good answer.
Thank you.
I appreciate it, because I saw the capital revenue and I thought, well, where's sales tax in here? And then that makes perfect sense that the county's holding that, so you wouldn't put it in your slide.
Yeah.
So thank you.
Yes, ma'am. So the bond interest, so this was the category I kind of quipped at earlier. We've got this broken down, and so these are numbers that when the 18-19 budget was developed, we worked with Dr. Thorpe's office to determine what things are we going to do with that money. The largest expense there are the mobile units. And those, so we have about 49 mobile units that are scattered throughout the county at different schools. Some, you know, they're not new really, and so we had And you'll see some pictures in a moment of the ones that we have already replaced with newer mobile units. And we've got a couple of other large projects that are happening there. And so that's why I feel confident that those bond interest dollars will be gone fairly soon, because I've seen those purchases starting to shift on through. This next slide touches on the $1 million that we received from the county this year, and it just sort of details the categories in which we're spending those dollars. So it's definitely going to brick and mortar needs, and so we can see the impact of that. And we'll conclude the presentation with some pictures that show examples of what we've done with those dollars, so you can see what you are getting for your money there. The next slide is just a history of our lottery funding from the 2009-2010 year and up. And so we're seeing the $1.5 million to $1.7 million range being sort of the new normal. And so coming here was from Caswell to Alamance was an interesting transition for me, in that Caswell has been banking their lottery money to go towards a new high school, which they're getting a new one. And here we need every penny of it to work on the various needs that we've got. And so we've been budgeting every penny of that money to try to make things happen. And so we hope that that continues to be a flow of money for us as we take on our projects. And this next slide is just a summary of the projects we're anticipating to use lottery money on. I know at least for the next several years, we'll continue to have $450,000 shaved off the top to go towards the Career and Technical Education Center. And we did quite a bit of painting this summer, and we've got some pictures of that for you. The water tap category was, I know that we connected Western Middle School to Ossipee's water. We had an exciting water leak with that not too long ago, but we've worked through that. And so that's been a nice improvement for us to work with the town of Ossipee on that water supply for Western Middle that started this summer. So let's get to the pictures. So this is just an example of some of the painting. Dr. Thorpe's office listed for me the schools where we had painting projects. And so we've got some pictures of those hallways with fresh paint. Looks really good. So these are some of the additional painting projects that happened. And we do, just with the volume of painting that we have, we do work with outside companies to help us get that amount of painting done in the summer months, because we've got to get it done when the kids are not in school. So we did remove some carpet, which I can't stand carpet, so I was excited to see that they're getting rid of the carpet. And we've got kids with, almost everybody's got some form of allergy now or some sinuses, and so it's nice that we're moving to this type of flooring in our facilities. So we've made that investment at a number of facilities this summer.
Do you happen to know where the carpet was at AO that was removed?
I do not, but I can find out for you.
Thank you.
We'll get some follow-up for you on that. So we did go through some classroom renovations, and Dr. Thorpe's office was able to pull sort of a list of the areas where we had work done to specific classrooms. I know a lot of that involves bringing our spaces just kind of up to the needs of the learning that's going on. With the exception of Highland, those are some really old buildings, and so we're just trying to get those classrooms in line with the type of learning that's going on in those spaces. I alluded to the roofing earlier. Broadview and Cummings have been sort of the most contentious roofing projects, but those are coming to an end. We did have to replace a section of roofing at Southern this shortly before the start of school this summer. But I think it's just a kind of it's like a game of whack-a-mole with roofing right now in inclement weather. So we did also replace some fire panels at some of our schools, just to try to bring those up to standard and provide the best systems we can have in place for those schools. We did have some flooding at the field house at Cummings, and we had to make some improvements to that space. And so as an alum, I was excited to see they were able to make those improvements. Here we've got some pictures of the new mobile units that were installed at Hillcrest and South Mebane. And I know you're thinking, hey, we just passed a bond and we're going to add 16 classrooms to South Mebane. Well, part of that will eliminate the need for those mobile units at South Mebane. And then ultimately we will cycle those through and replace some of the other old mobile units we have elsewhere with the ones that we have purchased for South Nevin. Alexander Wilson, we were able to put in some walkways to improve access and put a canopy in place for weather purposes. And then we were able to purchase some additional furniture, some new furniture for some of our schoolhouses. So we've got old buildings with old furniture in it, and we use furniture until it's absolutely worn down. So some of these cases, we needed to make some improvements to the furniture in the libraries, cafeterias, in the learning spaces. And then Dr. Thorpe's staff just put some additional projects on there for me of some other things that we have done with the capital dollars this summer. So that is my last slide, and I know it's a tremendous amount of information. We've got a lot going on. So I didn't know if there were any additional questions for me or Dr. Benson before I took a seat.
I got a question on security in the schools. Uh-huh. With all the incidents that are happening across the country. What are we doing as far as focusing on that?
Yes, so we've got a couple of things that have been rolled out. I know that we recently used one of our federal grants allowed for the purchase of safety equipment and in making some improvements in those spaces. And so now at each school, we're rolling this out in January. Now that we've gotten everything, there will be an Identikid kiosk at every school that requires visitors to check in. They have to scan their driver's license, and it checks databases to make sure that they're not a sexual offender or anything of that nature. And it's one of those barriers that it's not going to stop someone, but it can slow folks down.
Right.
We are also in the works of putting in vestibules or some enclosures in spaces. You know, we've got a number of schools where someone can get buzzed into the building, but then once you're in, you're in. And so Dr. Thorpe's area is working on a plan to put in place some additional layers so that once you're in, you're in a more confined space and someone needs to lay a little more look on you to make sure that you're legitimate before you can get too deep into the building.
I think that's a good idea.
Yeah.
Great idea.
That thing with Smith High School and the guy walking in and everything just brought that to my mind.
So we're just looking at anything we can do to at least slow folks down to give first responders an opportunity to be there. We received some additional funding. The state offered some grant opportunities this year. And so we received additional dollars for SRO support, and that's for the elementary level. So we're seeing an SRO presence even more so in our elementary schools. And then we're also replacing some outdated intercom equipment. We're finding at some of our schools that they've got so many buildings that are scattered everywhere, sometimes it's hard to communicate with the entire campus with existing intercoms. So we're replacing some intercom systems as well to improve communication.
I think Dr. Benson has he can't wait to talk
about it. Just to add from the procedural side of things is that we are working closely with local law enforcement. Actually, we have a meeting tomorrow morning with the sheriff's office to talk about training for our schools. We did our first active shooter training this year ever in the summer prior to the start of the school. We want to do more of that. We've had an opportunity to meet with agents from the State Bureau of Investigation and their interest and willingness to help us look at our physical facilities and determine whether or not there are improvements that they might be able to identify, as well as help us look at our threat assessment model. So we've got a lot of moving parts here that I think that will improve safety and security throughout the school system. And actually tomorrow, late afternoon, we're going to have our couple of agents from the SBI and a trainer from DPI come in and work with our principals and school resource officers and help folks understand how that partnership is supposed to work. So we've got a fair number of things in that area moving forward.
Thank you.
Let me ask a question about mobiles. You said we had how many mobiles, 50?
It's about 49.
49, 50, okay. You know, years ago, state average was of students in mobiles across the state was 10%.
Oh, wow.
And I think that would be under 5% technically for us, wouldn't it?
Yeah, and I think another concern that we have with that is so each year for the next 3 or 4 years, we're going to see a decrease in the number of kids we're allowed to have in a kindergarten through third grade.
Right.
And I know there's been a lot of chatter about that and the strain that's going to put on facilities. So that's going to be increasingly an answer for us at the elementary level if we keep on the track of dropping class sizes. But so right now, it's I don't think we want any. In a perfect world, we wouldn't have any, and so I'm glad that it's the percentage that it is. But we are nervous that we could have more as the average class size keeps having to drop based on state guidelines for K through 3.
I'm glad you've held it at the level that it's at, though. Mm.
Yeah.
Back in the spring when I was touring schools with Dr. Thorpe, in particular the high schools, the way the buildings are spread out and separated, discuss the issue of security there, trying to do a lockdown of the whole facility versus being able to even lock down one building at a time. Are we addressing that at all right now?
That's a tough question, and I'll look at the boss on that, but yeah.
So that is a particular challenge, and all of our schools develop safety plans that are unique to their facilities, and so the strategies that we use at an open campus are going to look a little bit different from a campus that we'll be able to secure, because all of the rooms are, you know, inside of a single building. Part of what we'll be looking at moving forward and getting some input from State Bureau of Investigation is what else can we do, you know, short of enclosing those schools, which is something that I think was looked at some number of years ago, and that was just cost prohibitive. But I'm confident there are additional measures that we can take in our open campus schools to improve security there as well. And one of those things has to do with the security of those doors and our ability to lock them electronically, which right now we don't have that ability.
Right.
Okay. Is there anything else? All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Chair.
We're going to have a 5-minute recess because I think a lot of people are going to change out of their seats. So let's have a 5-minute recess.
Jump out of the seats.
Change. I see a lot of school board people.
Timeframe of this year, the county received 6 proposals for these services, and the proposals were reviewed by the Sheriff's Department staff. And after reviewing the proposals and going through all the information in each packet, the Sheriff's Office is recommending that the provider Paytel receive this award. The proposed contract with Paytel will be for 3 years, and the contract also includes the ability to extend the agreement twice for 1 year periods each. There is no cost to Alamance County for these services. The county doesn't pay for these services. The inmates pay for the service. The county does receive a commission for the services when they're provided to the inmates. So, and in your packet that you received, you had a copy of the RFP that was put out by purchasing in the Sheriff's Department. Score sheet that staff put together after reviewing all the proposals and the proposed agreement. So this time, if the commissioners have any questions, I would certainly defer to the Sheriff's Office for any technical questions about the agreement. I will say that this process has been run according to county policy and state law, and it's been found acceptable. So we are prepared to support the recommendation of offering the work to Paytel. So if you have any questions, be happy to answer.
Sheriff, tell me how that works. How does your people that's in prison pay for the service that you provide?
The service is the phone system. They have to pay to make phone calls, to their family on the video visitation, etc. And all systems in the state is gone to that, you know, around the country. Paytel has the business in 54 counties in the state of North Carolina and the surrounding counties. And we checked and talked to some people. The closest IC Solutions was, I think, in Farmville, Virginia that we found. And I'm sure they're a good company. But Paytel is housed right out of Greensboro, North Carolina. And I can tell you, I'm getting tired of calling people for stuff at the jail that's in another state. Yeah, we'll be there next week, and then you see them a month later.
Yeah.
We would love to stay within the state of North Carolina because I can drive to Greensboro if I have to.
I think that's important, too. Shop local. That's a good theory.
Yes, sir.
It is interesting that they both come out equally. What does Paytel have to offer that would... My fact that they're local.
What I found, you know, service, quick to come, maintenance, you can call immediately, you know, and they work. If you looked at what they do, it's pretty equal. But Paytel, their reputation with the agencies we contacted, which some of those sheriffs I know real well, sold me on Paytel. So, and it's
through the process, right?
And let me say this. Nothing against the other companies, but Paytel is a company in North Carolina, and the money would be staying in North Carolina.
How does an inmate pay for the phone service?
Their people can put money in
an account.
Right, in an account, same thing.
Like a debit card?
They can. Right.
Okay.
I'll make the motion, we support it.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to approve the visitations, the phone and video visitation services contract as outlined by the county manager. Is there any more discussion?
Can you give an estimate of, let's say, I get in jail, Bill, you come visit me. Send somebody. How much does it cost? I mean, for instance, are you talking about...
It depends on the amount of time you talk.
When you're on the other side of the glass and you're at a table and you're talking, so you get billed for that?
No.
You don't get billed for that? Oh, okay.
It's a video service. It's like video. Online video.
Online.
Situation.
Oh, okay. What cost you nothing, Bill?
Come on down the scene.
I'll come see you, Tim.
Nobody else will, so I'll hold you to it. All right.
All right. We have a motion and a second. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, Ms. Osborne.
Yes.
Family Justice Center has a renewal of a grant period.
Yes, I have several things, so we'll start with that. So this finance needs the commissioners to approve acceptance of this grant. It's the Governor's Crime Commission grant. Does not require a county match. $756,177. Family Justice Centers are a priority for the Governor's Crime Commission. This money is used locally in our Family Justice Center, and we contract with Family Abuse Services for positions with them as well. You have a fact sheet explaining the grant, proposals, the goals, the contracted personnel, and the, of course, the outcomes that are projected.
And
this
no
grant.
County match.
2 years. The county match is in kind. Okay. You know, you provide the building, those things.
I'll make a motion to approve.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to approve. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Thank you. Okay, now we have a grant application for the family, for the FJC.
So we have an elder justice grant. We will come to the end of our second year in September, the end of our grant year in September of 2019. We have been encouraged to apply for continuation funding. This grant focuses on training mostly law enforcement and our district attorney's office on financial exploitation, and how to recognize and be aware of elder abuse. We would like to apply for that grant through Office of Violence Against Women and Governor's Crime Commission, because we feel like this is an expansion of Family Justice Centers into the elder abuse arena, and we like to be kind of trailblazers with that. So we are asking for permission to apply for those two grants that will start when our current grant ends.
I have a note that we need to have two separate votes, one for the grant for the Office for Violence Against Women, mm-hmm. So, and then a second vote
for the Governor's Crime Commission grant.
So we would be seeking first a motion, if anybody wants to make one, to approve the Office for Violence Against Women grant.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second for that. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Okay, and then second, we are seeking a motion to approve the grant application for the Governor's Crime Commission on Elder Abuse.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second for that one. Is there any more discussion?
Well, none of these will stop robocalls trying to get my money, though, right?
No, not
one. Yes, sir. I'm afraid not.
Is that elder abuse thing?
Yeah, that's elder abuse, definitely.
That's right.
Okay, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed?
I would like to add that the Impact Alamance has a program to allow us to apply for grant writer services, so they have funded us writing these two grants and are providing some assistance to us.
Excellent.
Thank you.
Yes.
And then you have a social service agreement revision.
Yes, I do.
Would you like to
with our county
manager?
Lead
off?
Well, I can. So you got lots of documents in this packet. I'll practice summarizing this on Commissioner Sutton and Commissioner Boswell the other day. So what you have is a new MOU. If you remember, we spent some time in the spring discussing with Clyde Albright's help and crafting a signing statement that went along with our approval to the MOU required by the Department of Health and Human Services, which is performance indicators on your County Department of Social Services, 26 indicators. And the consequences of not meeting those indicators, if you remember, was corrective action plans and ultimately the possibility of withholding of federal funds. I'm happy to report that we have been in constant communication, the County Commissioners Association and the Association of County Directors of Social Services with our state around these MOUs. And what you have is a revised MOU, an amendment. That amendment says pretty much two things. These measures, some of them, if you remember when we talked about them, were dependent upon court time, they were dependent upon other systems that the county really didn't have much of an impact. Right. And if we failed them, then we would be penalized. So the newest amendment that you have before you moves many, many of those measures to growth measures and a realization that the county needs to provide leadership in moving a community towards that. And growth measures in terms of measuring where the county is now and what is reasonable growth. And instead of expecting everybody to be at 95%, if you're at 60%, you might need to move from 60 to 65 next year. So we have those 17 of the 26 have moved to growth measures. There will be no corrective action this year through June 30th in this new amendment. We're in the process of validating data right now, and so I recommend, and you'll have to hear from your county manager, but I recommend signing this amendment, because if we don't, we'll stay under the old one, which is much more stringent.
Well, Susan speaks very well to this. She is the head of her association and has worked very hard to make sure the county's perspective has been included at the state level. And that's very important to us, because the original agreement gave us all some concerns. In fact, Mr. Albright drafted a statement to put along with ours to send down saying, we're signing this because the law says we have to, but we have some real concerns about it. So after talking with Susan and with Clyde and looking over the revised terms, I think it is a better agreement for the county. They are making it very clear there's not going to be any corrective action against the county this fiscal year. I think the state has listened to feedback they received from the counties and is working to try to make this a better agreement. So I would certainly recommend to the board that we do sign it. We do have to sign it by law, but I think it is a much better agreement. Thank you to Susan and her association for the hard work they've done to try to get it rectified. So it does take board approval, and then Susan and I will both sign it as we did the original.
I will move that we do that.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve the agreement that the law requires us to approve. There's not going to be any discussion. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Thank you.
It's hard to vote against something you're required to vote.
Yes, right. It is. Thank you very much.
We could try it, Bill, but I don't know.
We all went to jail a couple of years ago over that. I think that was the one time of day. Remember that? Threatened to put us in jail if we didn't
sign something.
Yeah, I remember something like that. I don't remember what it was.
I can't remember what it was.
That's why I asked, would you visit?
All right. So, Mr. Haygood, you got something about the Mental Health Diversion and Restoration Center Director position request.
Yes, Madam Chair, Commissioners, I'm here this evening to ask that you consider and approve the creation of a new county employee position. I don't usually do this in the middle of a fiscal year, but these funds that I'm proposing to use are mental health maintenance of effort funding that we must use by law to provide mental health services, and I hope that you'll agree that this is a reasonable way to do so. The county is required to budget $1,203,556 every year in MOE money, maintenance of effort money. These are mental health funds that we have to spend annually. This comes back from back when the state divested the counties of the legal requirement to provide mental health services. but the dollar amount that the county was spending at that time was frozen, and it was $1.2 million. So we're still required by law to budget this money. It is county tax dollars, but it's money that we're required to spend on these type services. Back in 2017, until 2017, we had been allocating these funds to Cardinal Innovations, which is the state group that provides mental health services for Alamance County, and we have been giving those funds to Cardinal, and they would divvy out what to do with it on our behalf. In 2017, we took those funds back. Cardinal recommended that we do that. We work with them, and we now contract directly with the mental health maintenance of effort money with four different groups: RHA Health Services. RHA provides a crisis service for residents of Alamance County. If you're experiencing crisis, you can go there and see folks that will help you. We also contract with ARMC for the provision of nurses and staff in the ER that help people that are having mental health issues. Ralph Scott Life Services, we contract with those folks to provide transportation for folks with developmental disabilities and mental health issues, as well as residential treatment services of Alamance County. We contract with them to spend MOE money with those folks also to help provide medicine for the people that residential treatment services treats. So we contract out this $1.2 million to all those different groups. We've been doing it now for the past 2 years, and each year we have a balance left of $54,305. So what I'm proposing to do is that we use this $54,305 of maintenance of effort funds, these mental health funds, to create a new county position. This position would be allocated to the Alamance County Health Department. The health department, there would be costs above this $54,305. Those costs would be the benefits, and if the if it would be a county employee, so it could be subject to any kind of merit raise or any of those other type programs that any other county employee would be subject to. Those would be the responsibility of the health department to find those funds. The $54,305 would always come from the mental health money. This person would be called the Restoration Center Director, and we have several functions that we believe this position could serve. The position would oversee the development of the new mental health diversion and restoration center that we've received $1.2 million from Cardinal Innovations, and then Mr. Petrie has also graciously donated up to $500,000 to help take the old elderly services building and turn it into the mental health diversion center. So this person would be responsible for coordinating that project. We have an RFP out right now to find architect or designer to go in and give us specs that we can build out, bid out to fix that building up. So this person would be responsible for handling that part of the project, as well as once the diversion center is open. This would be very similar to the Family Justice Center, for we have a county employee that works in the Family Justice Center, coordinates the day-to-day activities there, and all the nonprofits, they're like the liaison between county government and the folks that are in the Family Justice Center. This person would be the same thing for the mental health groups that would be in the diversion center. They would also manage these mental health contracts. So we now contract directly with all these different companies, these four different providers, but we need someone that is watching those contracts, making sure that each one of those providers are doing what the contract says. And just recently, within the past year or so, the commissioners have created the Justice Advisory Council. And the Justice Advisory Council really is going to be in a position to make recommendations about how to better spend these funds and what kind of terms to put in the contracts so we can expect better mental health services out of our providers. This employee would be responsible for making sure that what the JAC wants to enact would come before the commissioners and then go into the contracts, and there would be some accountability there. And the final task, main task for the new position, would be to coordinate the county's opioid crisis response. You know, we've had a lot of work, a tremendous amount of work from our health department, social services, and many other county departments, including EMS and several other ones, working to try to help our county combat the opioid crisis. And there's been a lot of strategies designed and put forward, and someone needs to follow through with those strategies, and this would be the person. So in your packet, you have a job description for the Restoration Center Director. You also have a letter of support from the Board of Health. We have Stacy Saunders here with us this evening, who would, of course, be the ultimate supervisor of this position. At this time, I would be happy to answer any questions about it, and therefore.
Can I ask some questions?
I'm
sounds like you worked through what you need there, your description of the job and so forth.
Well, and I think the key for me from a budgetary perspective is the lion's share, the vast amount of these funds are mental health funds that we must spend somehow on mental health services.
That will be spent no matter what, right?
Yes.
So.
I see this as a benefit of taking, this is one benefit for us taking back the direct contracting, and we're able to make these kind of decisions.
Gives us control more so over the funds as they filter through.
That's correct.
The mental health has to come up with the any increases in salary.
Yes.
And it, and the benefits expense.
That's correct.
So we would be seeking a motion to approve the position request.
So moved.
Second that.
All right, we have a motion and a second. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Okay, got a fiscal policy revision.
Commissioner, so we are working to prepare ourselves for the upcoming bonds. And part of that process, as we identified back in March as we were working through our capital plan, was to make some revisions to our fiscal policies. So what I'm requesting for you to consider this evening is that you approve the new fiscal policy that's included in your packet. I've put in your packet the new policy as well as the existing one. And you'll notice there are call-outs in the new policy that give you some idea of what we're changing. We also, the Minitrack cover sheet will give you a pretty good idea of the main points, excuse me, that we're wanting to change. This new version of the fiscal policy has been drafted with the help of our county finance department, of course, our legal department, and with Davenport, the folks that have been helping us navigate our way through planning for these $189 million worth of bonds. And the hope is the new version of these fiscal policies will help us do a lot of things, but one of the main things I hope that it will help us do is when we go to issue debt, we'll be reviewed by the credit rating agencies. And we hope that having some of these things in place will put us in a position to possibly get a credit upgrade, which would save us on interest, of course. Just a few examples of the changes. I'm not going to read the entire policy to you, but I wanted to make sure you had a good idea of what these new the changes include. Now, we put some new guidelines regarding capital planning, regular reporting to the board, and deferred maintenance in the fiscal policies. We've also included, if you remember back in March, we had a few debt ratio indicators that Davenport recommended that we put in our policies or make some changes to ones that were already in our policies. The first one is that tax-supported debt shall be limited to 3% of assessed value of taxable property. Currently, our policy limits it to 8%. So what that does is it lowers the total debt amount that we would have in our policy from over $1 billion, that's the dollar amount we could be in debt, we could have in debt, to $420 million. That would be, by our policy, our max, and we feel like that's a reasonable amount. Second debt ratio indicator is that debt service shall be limited to 15% rather than 10% of general fund expenditures. This is an increase because we know if we do these bonds, we're going to be paying out more, it's going to be a higher payment. So we would recommend raising that ratio from 10% to 15%. And the final debt ratio indicator is a 10-year principal payout ratio set at 50%. This is per the capital plan. This has a bearing on our structured debt. You know, we've talked a lot about should we do structured debt, right. Could we do structured debt. If we were going to try to do structured debt, the state, of course, has some policies in place, the 4-to-1 ratio that we would have to abide by, but this policy would also keep us in line to make sure that we're not putting ourselves in a bad financial place. We would also recommend in these policies changing the unassigned fund balance percentage. Currently, unassigned fund balance percentage, our target is 25%. We are not there and are not probably going to get to 25% anytime soon. So we instead of setting ourselves up for failure, we would recommend that we reduce that to 20%. That would make $30.4 million our target to have in fund balance, which I believe right now we have 18.3 per our last audit. So. And the policy also requires that we do quarterly finance reports and have a biannual investment report to the board. Our auditors have made it plain to us it's important. You're approving budget amendments you need to have in front of you regularly financial reports from the county, so you could be in the know. We do have all the existing policy guidelines, for the very most part, have been included in the revised policy. There are a couple of exceptions. Guideline 1.6, this is one I call out because it's important for you to think about. It conflicts with our plan to issue bond debt per our capital finance plan. So guideline 1.6 in the original policy says the tax rate shall be set each year based on the cost of providing general government services. Rates shall be adjusted periodically, but shall not result in revenues exceeding a 5% annual growth rate in ad valorem tax revenues, excluding growth in valuation or an increased collection rate. So if we kept the policy as it is today, the maximum property tax rate increase that we would be able to do by our policy is 2.95 cents. We know, as I put to you, that that would not cover the cost of the bonds. So I would recommend that we take that piece out. It is still within the purview of the County Board of Commissioners to set the property tax rate. You will still get a recommended budget from me that includes capital and operating. So it just seems like it would behoove us not to have a policy that goes against what we see coming.
When was that policy instituted? You're saying we couldn't raise taxes past 2.9, right? Okay, when was that instituted?
So this policy was last approved in 2016, but I think that was primarily for the fund balance percentage change at that time. So I'm not sure when this was approved in its original format. So I don't know. So
it's been historically, I think one of the last times that was brought before the board was back in 2004.
Wow. Oh, so I'm trying to figure it out. If that was there, how'd you get 5 cents when the bill and I were gone?
Slid that right by him.
Hey, he thought I was going to overlook it.
Yeah.
Where are they? 5 cents?
There were also several
questions. You got an answer on that? I mean,
no, I don't. I don't have an answer for that. You know, the board
can do what they please.
Right. That's true.
That's what I think he's saying. Yes. No matter what the policies are.
It is. And I think we're trying to put our best foot forward with the credit rating agency, so we want them to be as accurate as possible. But these policies do have some statements in them that say the board can opt to not go by the policy. So if there is a time that we found ourselves in a need to do something financially that didn't go by the policy, that's still possible. But it would mean I'm supposed to come to you and explain this is where we are, this is what we need to do. I think it's more of a communication tool to make sure you understand as a board what we're proposing to do as staff. And I think it's also a good communication to the rating agencies to let them know we're on top of our finances, we're in clear communication with you, and all's well in the world in Alamance County financially. So, we do have several other pieces of the existing policy that are not included, and it just seemed like they were normal operations as opposed to a need for an actual policy listing. These include 1.4, assessed valuation shall be estimated based on historical trends and growth patterns, which we do on a regular basis every year. 2.3 recommended that performance measures will be implemented, which they have been. 6.4, financial condition will maintain minimum bond ratings, which we certainly strive to do. 7.3, collections will be closely monitored, which Jeremy's folks do a great job keeping up with collections. And we have a system of inventory control as 7.8 required that we establish. So we also remove guideline 2.5 regarding the distinguished budget award. We will work towards that goal. That is not one that we have received yet, but we will continue to work toward it. But I think it's going to take some more work in the finance department to get us to that place. We have CAFRs and PAFRs. We're doing both of those awards now, and we'll work on the budget award. If you have any questions, I'll be happy to try to answer them. And we have a great team of folks here that have worked very hard on this. So I feel confident if you have questions, we should be able to answer
them. Well, I've got a question about, I thought I heard back when we met with Davenport that the more money, if you owed money, they liked that in the bond rating because they thought, well, you're willing to raise taxes to pay for it. You're progressive, blah, blah, blah. Now it seems like there's a reversal here. Is there somewhat of a?
Well, I think what the rating agencies would like to see is that we're acknowledging that we're watching our finances, we're watching our borrowing percentages, and we're communicating that to the commissioner. So I think that's really the key part of these policies. Now they'll analyze our debt loads, and all that will be examined when we go to issue the debt. I don't know if Ted, if you had anything to add.
I might just add, I don't think it's necessarily, I'm Ted Cole with Davenport.
Yes.
How much debt you have outstanding, but certainly for any amount of debt you have outstanding, they want to see that it can be repaid in a sustainable fashion from current year revenues as opposed to one-time revenues. But and they certainly, the rating agencies are supportive of elected officials that are willing to, you know, balance the budget in a sustainable way in order to, you know, take on additional debt and projects. But I don't think necessarily any amount of debt, more or less, is looked at favorably or not, as long as, you know, needs are being met. And, you know, there's a discussion about the CIP. Part of the policy is developing an annual CIP and then funding that CIP based on your annual budget process. I'll just, one last thing I'll say, and I think the county manager did an excellent job of explaining all of this. From a rating agency perspective, and I realize they're not the only audience out there, but they really do find comfort in the fact that if there are policies that they are board adopted, they certainly understand that when you have certain policies that have percentages assigned to them, that there may be a reason, a very good reason, to go through that percentage, high or low, whatever it is. And rather than just adjusting the policy to accommodate whatever it is that you want or need to do, it's my opinion, and we've seen this in a number of occasions, that the board being able to make an exception to a policy, particularly by virtue of a planning process that's underway and your staff brings to you, if we do this, we will need to make an exception to the policy. What the rating agencies get comfort is that there's that conversation going on and that you all are making decisions knowing all the facts, and you know, and that an exception is being made, but you do so knowingly, and ideally you make a commitment to get back into compliance within some reasonable period of time. So it's really about the process and the dialogue, less so about the specific percentage or whether you've got lots of capacity or a little bit of capacity. So I think the process in and of itself is really where the value is.
Let me ask you a question. We talked about this when we did meet. If you look at the ratings of the mega counties, they're in debt up to their earlobes, in my opinion, some of them, they got AAA ratings. And you come down to the level where, you know, we're sitting here looking at next to the, if not, for all intents and purposes, lowest bond indebtedness per capita of any county out of 20-some counties we're in a group of. Yet we only get the AA minus or whatever. No AAAs in that group, I don't believe. Might be, but I don't remember seeing any. But what's the, I mean, do they think it's going to pay their bills better than
well? The rating agencies have moved to a much more transparent and consistent methodology of rating local governments. Debt accounts for 10-20% of the rating, so it's not a key drive. It's an important factor. Economy is 30%, and when you're talking about economy, you're talking about the tax base,
okay,
the tax base per capita. You're talking about wealth levels. That's 30% of the rating. Finances are about 30% of the rating. Management is 20%, and debt's 20% generally. So many times, those local governments that are AAA rated, which is the highest rating you can achieve, are generally high growth. The economy is growing. Again, that's about 30% of the rating. And with high growth comes a lot of capital needs, so they tend to also be those counties that have the highest amounts of debt. But there are other dynamics going on that the rating agencies believe are offsetting to that fact.
So where are we looking to get in our rating by?
You're a AA rated county, and within AA there are three levels. Within AA, and then you get to AAA. So I think
our goal in this whole effort has been not only to get the funding when you all determine you need it, but also to do it in a way that even though we're taking on almost $200 million of projects over the next several years, that we can improve on the county's bond rating. I don't believe that it's inconceivable that over time the county could achieve a AAA bond rating. May not happen in the next 2 to 5 years, but we'd like to see that you can move incrementally higher in the AA rating, and then perhaps one day, if a number of other things kind of fall into place, that it would be a reasonable expectation to get to that AAA. One of the rating agencies is a little more stingy with that AAA than the other, so while they are very similar in their approach, they're not exactly the same, and it's not uncommon for a county to have rating disparity from one or the other. One's higher, one's lower, but you're very well positioned, and we believe strongly that moving forward, we can put a plan in place and demonstrate the rating agencies there's an opportunity to improve the rating. And I think these policies are just sort of one of those boxes to check. And, they'll be watching sort of the budget process and the political will to do what you all need to do to be able to fund this new debt in a sustainable fashion.
Who campaigns to get those ratings up? Did we do it?
They want to hear from the county. Right. So it is some combination of elected officials and staff that
the sheriff do it.
Will meet. That will meet with the rating analyst and tell the story. And they do a lot of their own research, obviously, but it's always nice for them. They can pull audits and budgets and look at all the data. But I think it's also important for them to hear from you all on the more subjective or qualitative factors that they need to consider.
So how long did you say you thought it might take us to get to a AAA rating?
Honestly, some few years. I don't know, a number of years.
Can we have that put in writing?
I think it may be, but caveat that, I appreciate the question. It's not only about are you improving,
right,
your rating measures or your ratios, but are you improving at a pace that is greater than the national or North Carolina medians are improving? So everybody might be, not everybody, but a majority might be improving certain wealth indicators. And if you're just moving with the group,
right,
you're not really getting ahead. So it is a little bit difficult in terms of sort of mapping this out in time. I would just say I think it's a process. Every step towards AAA that you are working on gets harder and harder. But I don't think it's inconceivable over some near medium term time frame to think that could be achievable.
All right, well, let's get started with that tonight. If anybody wants to make a motion
to
approve the fiscal policy revisions as presented. Do we have a motion?
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Thank you. Okay, we have a couple of budget amendments, one from the library.
All right, cool.
Hello, Commissioners.
Hello.
In case you don't know, I'm Susanna Goldman. I'm the acting interim director for the libraries after our library director retired. So I have a budget amendment before you. We have we were awarded a state funding grant that was more than we were expecting to get. So there's an increase of $2,242 that we need to move, and we need to add to our budget, and we would like to add that toward the purchase of books this year. If you have any questions.
I'll make a motion that we approve that.
I'll second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to approve that budget amendment. Is there any more discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Anyone opposed? Thank you.
You're done.
That's it. Okay, and Mr. Hill.
Yeah.
afternoon, Commissioners.
So I'm here to ask for your approval to transfer about $251,000 from our retained earnings, our unrestricted savings, if you will, to purchase a new Caterpillar excavator. We had originally proposed to replace this excavator in next year's budget, but it went south on us a few weeks ago. We've been through about four rebuilds, and you get the idea. So we've just determined it's going to be better to go buy a new one, take the existing unit, put it on GovDeals. We have a much older 1990 model Hitachi that's idle. We're also going to put that on GovDeals. So we anticipate between the two pieces of equipment generating some $50,000 to $100,000 in revenue. That kind of offsets the $250,000 we're asking. We don't have this year's audit yet, but we're looking at unrestricted funds north of $9 million coming up on the audit, so there's plenty of money to take care of it.
I would make a motion that we approve that.
Great. We have a motion and a second to approve that budget amendment for the landfill. Is there any discussion or questions? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed?
Thank you
so much. Mr. Hager, do you have a report?
Just a few quick things. First of all, I'd like to thank Susanna for stepping up and being the interim at the library. Appreciate her work very much. And you also have in your packet a copy of the fiscal update for November 2018. You can look through it. This is part of our keeping the board informed financially. And the last piece I just wanted to cover, as you have read and heard this evening, last week the planning board met and did discuss the heavy industrial development ordinance. The planning board has made a recommendation that the commissioners consider a moratorium on receiving heavy industrial development ordinance applications for 59 days. And the planning board is scheduled to meet again on January 10th. I'll be working with Tanya Cattle, our planning director, to try to get some possible changes and points of real interest that we've heard from the folks from the snow camp area that are unhappy about the quarry. Try to get those things cataloged in a way that can be presented to the planning board to give some consideration to those points. And we'll be very specific about what those should be or could be. And we'll also be sure that the planning board has the opportunity to look at some sample ordinances similar to what we do here from other counties, because we know that there are other folks that have these same issues and are trying to protect their people. So the planning board has made this recommendation of a moratorium. I think if we meet on January 10th with the planning board and go over these possible changes at the January 22nd county commissioners meeting, we should be able to bring you back some level of changed ordinance or their recommendation to do the moratorium. So I hope to be able to have an answer for you at the January 22nd meeting. In the meantime, I do want to let the board know that we've taken several steps to try to prevent this particular issue. Was that the board didn't know about this permit, the planning board didn't know about this permit, very few folks knew about it. Per the ordinance, it was handled by the planning director. We have changed our central permitting software to where now if someone comes to the planning department and applies for a permit for any of these uses in the heavy industrial development ordinance, immediately, as soon as the application is filed into the software, I get an email, Mr. Albright gets an email, we have IT, GIS, everyone in county government that's remotely connected to this gets an email to say this has been filed, there is now a permit. In fact, I think just today we added the superintendent of the school system to this, because the schools had some interest in making sure they were aware if something heavy industrial was going right nearby. So the superintendent will also get an email. Then once, if the permit is approved, a second email will be sent out. So I would be alerting the board. I would be calling you, emailing you to say there has been an application filed. Then through that period of review and evaluation of the application, if at the end it's approved, that goes into the software system. Everybody gets another email. I would be letting everybody know, okay, the project at such and such has been approved. And also, I want to make sure the board knows and the public that you can currently go on the county's GIS system and see where all the approved, unbuilt heavy industrial development apps are at in county, around the county. And there's also a little more user-friendly non-GIS-based map available on the County Planning Department's website. So we hope those are ways that we can make sure that folks stay informed per the ordinance. This is all within compliance with the ordinance. So if you have any questions, I'll be happy to try to answer them, but my plan is to come back on the 22nd with more information about the ordinance itself. So.
I hear you say that everybody would be notified if the application was made. I thought I heard you say if the permit was granted.
There'll be two emails. So when the let's say a developer comes in to planning and wants to file today to start a new quarry, there's a process the planning department puts in. As soon as it's entered in, because it's entered in right then into the software, an email is sent out automatically as soon as it
is. So the permit wouldn't be granted.
Permit's not granted, but everybody gets a notice. Then the second email goes out if the permit is granted. If they're found to be compliant, it's okay to grant the permit. Everybody gets a second email. So, and again, my function would be to make sure the board knows there has been a permit applied for by Brian Hagan to do whatever the permit was for.
I've got a question. I don't even know if this is possible since we do not do zoning. But, you know, the municipalities, if they're going to rezone a property, they put the notification around the property basically to let the neighborhood know we're considering doing something with this property. Is that something we can even do? I mean,
that was discussed at the planning board meeting. There were, you know, some ideas thrown around by the planning board about posting notices, making that part of the ordinance where surrounding, there would be something posted at the property or surrounding property owners would get a letter. So I couldn't speak to the legality of those things.
They can change the ordinance. They recommended the change in 2011 from the high impact land use order.
Right.
And if they see fit, they can bring any changes to this board for approval.
You know, I think that gives community notification. Hey, we're thinking about granting something here that.
In fact,
they
I believe
be interested in.
The ordinance says it passed. You're supposed to put the development on the Register of Deeds website, but we never.
Yeah, but if I drive by the property,
step.
I see a
right.
particular yellow what, sign what out, I know something's.
What you're talking about generally is done in rezoning. So
right.
other counties that have zoning, you get the big yellow sign
yeah.
with the notice on.
I think I can speak to that too, since I was at the planning board meeting, because I'm the commissioner who goes to that. But the planning board, I think, was unanimous in saying yes, there should be a notification requirement, but they really didn't get into a discussion of what they would recommend to this board that notification requirement should actually look like. And so I think that's why it's a good idea for them to have another crack at it before we come back on the 22nd, so that they can maybe flesh that out for us a little bit more.
You can see the map, Bruce has it pulled up on the screen there. So this is the map that's available on the County Planning Department's website, and it shows the locations of approved heavy industrial development permits that have not been built yet. Because there are some out there that were approved and haven't been built. So this map, and it's also on the county's GIS website. It's a default layer, so if you go to the county's GIS, they're automatically up and on. You have to actually take action to turn them off. So.
And I was at, Commissioner Carter and I were at our ethics training last week, and I had the opportunity to talk to a commissioner from Lee County, and they had, I don't know if y'all remember, before they built 40 to get to the beach, you used to ride down 87 South. Mm-hmm. And in Lee County, there's Carolina Trace. It's that nice development that's on the left as you're headed south, the golf course and stuff. They have a rock quarry that's going in that's got applied for a special use permit really close to there. So I would like for us to include in our list of counties that we look at how they do things. Look at Lee County and maybe some context of what's happened there in the last few months, since they've been through a similar ordeal with also people very, very upset results there. But that was a special use permit that they were requesting, not just an ordinance like we have. So obviously when we compare to other counties, we're going to see other counties do different things. So I would like for that to be included, please.
I was thinking that was one of the counties we went to back in developing.
They have countywide zoning, as does Guilford. Mm-hmm. And the board, I don't know if you know it, but the rock quarry that was proposed for Pleasant Garden in Guilford County was not approved. by the planning board or the commissioner last November.
I think that's an interesting point, that just because you have countywide zoning doesn't necessarily, you know, erase the situation
that's
where
right.
you have unusual use coming into a nice residential area. So.
That's correct.
What would our options be had we learned of this before it got approved by the state?
Well, the ordinance as it is written is a spacing ordinance. The planning board in 2011 had about 8 or 9 months of meetings with citizens. And I mean, they met with everyone, the environmentalists, the real estate folks, the builders, landowners, farmers. And they decided the best way to handle this was the spacing requirement. And they set it up in tiers based on the industry classification.
And acreage
right.
involved.
And our ordinance, the heavy industry development ordinance, if you go and just read it, it's only 17 pages. It actually mentions hog farms. So, limiting to 250 hogs, though. But I find that interesting that that was the system that the citizens put together and then brought to the board, and the board approved that spacing system. It could be changed. It's a local law, and you folks can change local laws. But as for the permit that's been approved already, I don't think you can change that.
Can't backtrack.
That's all.
All right, thank you. Do any of the other commissioners have comments? I do. Y'all don't. I'll do last. First, working on our committee assignments now, with Commissioner Carter being here, he has a list of the committees and the assignments if anybody else wants to review that, and that's available. I was asked to remind everybody that the Piedmont Triad Regional Council, is that what it stands for? PTRC 50th anniversary celebration is in Alamance County on January 30th at 8:30 in the morning. So, and I know I will be there.
I will too.
Very quickly, I thought it would be, this is the last meeting of 2018, and I thought maybe we'd take a moment to think about what we have done as a county organization. First, we got the bonds ready to go on the ballot, and there were things that had to be timed out just right to get that work done. We didn't want to be the reason that the bonds didn't get on a ballot, and we weren't. Well, they were on the ballot, so that was well done. We did a budget in June. We had two elections. There was a question we knew at the beginning of the year that 287G was going to come up and was going to be discussed, and it has been discussed. And then there were things that at the beginning of the year that we didn't know we were going to deal with, like the MVP pipeline, and we spent a lot of time and energy thinking about that. We had two hurricanes, a winter storm. The county declared two states of emergency, and now we've got a situation with the quarry and looking at the high industrial development ordinance. So next year, I think we know where we're going to be looking at with land use and things like that, and getting our money's worth out of our planning director, bless her heart. And then the last thing I wanted to mention, and I have her permission to mention this, this is the last meeting for Susan Osborne. She has taken a job as the assistant secretary for the North Carolina Department of Health and Human Services, overseeing county operations.
Congratulations.
So. Last day, and I knew about this because I'm on the DSS board. I'm the commissioner representative to that. So the DSS board is actually, by statute, who has the duty to choose the new planning director. So we will be working on that. Her last day is January 18th. So this is her last commissioner meeting, and we're just so happy for you and know that you're going to do great. I don't know if you have to drive back and forth to Raleigh. Bless your heart.
I'm probably going to stay during the week.
Yeah.
We'll leave at 5 o'clock in the morning.
Weekend. Yeah, right. Good luck with that. But we will miss you very much.
Yeah, thank you.
And we wish you all the best. And thank you from the bottom of our hearts for all your years of hard service to this county. And it's a blessing to know that other counties around the state are going to get the benefit of that wisdom and experience now. So. So thank you so much, Susan.
Thank you.
Thank you. All right. And if there's no further business before the board, we'll be adjourned.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
'Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners occur on the first and third Monday of every month in the Commissioners' Chambers at the County Office Building at 124 West Elm Street in Grand. Typically, the first meeting of the month occurs at 9 a.m. and the second meeting occurs at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. The video of this meeting is broadcast on LocalGov TV. Please go to www.localgovtvnc.com for more information about this schedule and to see more videos produced by your local governments. You can also access this meeting through our website at www.alamance-nc.com or at our YouTube channel. Technical questions regarding this meeting's broadcast or production may be sent to our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. This address is for technical questions only. Comments and questions about the content of the meeting may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. There, you can click on the link that says County Commissioners to learn more about our commissioners, read minutes and agendas of commissioner meetings, and find other information about the county commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Thanks for tuning in. If you're watching on YouTube, be sure to hit the subscribe button to stay up to date on all our latest video content. If you're watching on LocalGov TV, be sure to visit their website to see all of the content made for you by your local governments.